It's time to focus on today's educational issues. Issues that affect you, your kids, community, and your tax dollars. Topics like violence, legislation, special needs, the gifted, curriculum, technology, the parents' role, building self-esteem, and minorities' needs. How do we deal with substance abuse, AIDS, sports, and very importantly, funding?
Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host. In the world of business, the world of work, business and industry, they are demanding skills and abilities beyond reading, writing, computing, even beyond technology and critical thinking. They want people who can work in teams cooperatively. But many of our schools are still designed for lonely learning in competition. I wonder, how do students learn best? In competition or in cooperative learning? Well, I'm honored today to have a wonderful guest, an expert in cooperative learning, Dr. Roger Johnson, professor at University of Minnesota, author. He's a consultant throughout the world and all over the United States, and he is indeed the expert on cooperative learning. Welcome, Dr. Johnson.
Thank you.
Thank you. Before we start, I think I owe a little debt of thanks to Dr. Jerry Thornell.
Yes, you
who
do.
Who is directing a summer institute here at Bridgewater State College. And he invited you to be the keynote speaker, and I'm just delighted that he made arrangements for you to be here with us on School Talk. Are you enjoying your visit here to the Northeast?
Very much, yes.
Well, I'm glad, because sometimes our weather can confuse people. I think we'll start right at the beginning. People want to know, where did this come from? Is this a new idea? So perhaps you could give us just a brief history of cooperative learning.
Yeah, it's actually a very old idea. I mean, probably as old as people, because we are a gregarious species, and we have been teaching each other from the very beginning in families and clusters and villages. One of my favorite quotes is from a Roman scholar who once said, Quintilian by the name, who once said, quidocit discet.
Well,
working on my Latin here. What that says is, he who teaches learns twice.
Excellent.
And an emphasis there. Certainly the best of the one-room schoolhouses were all done very cooperatively, often within a family, brothers and sisters helping each other. Mm-hmm. And maybe one of the most famous, if you want to look at the history in this New England area of the cooperative learning people, was Colonel Francis Parker, who was at one time the superintendent of Quincy. And thousands of people came to visit his schools while he was superintendent of Quincy, because he had cooperative groups working. He felt that one of the reasons you learn something is so you can share it with other people, so you can give it away. And he also realized the value of that, the value of talking through what you're learning verbally with somebody else, and how that deepens your own understanding. So it's got a rich history. One of his students, by the way, John Dewey, was also very good at using cooperative learning.
That name rings a bell with most educators. In fact, I'm quite interested in what they put in your brochure here on the flyer about your summer institute. One of your workshops was called Cooperative Learning. It's a lot more than moving desks around.
True.
So will you just give us a definition for this discussion of cooperative learning?
I will. It's a good start to move desks around. It's a good start to put students together with each other, but from our perspective or point of view, that's kind of, you're at the starting line. You're at the beginning now. The question is, how do I get this little cluster or group of students to work together cooperatively? And a good definition maybe of cooperation is in any area, whether it's a marriage or a work group or a friendship or a math group in a school, mm-hmm. is you're in a cooperative relationship when you're linked together with other people in a way that you can't be successful unless they are. And they can't be successful without you. And probably there are five things that need to go into that if we if we draw from social interdependence theory. I won't go into depth in these, but one of them is called positive interdependence. And positive interdependence is this sink or swim together recognition. Mm-hmm. I can't be successful unless you are, and you can't be successful without me. A second one, though, probably equally important, would be individual accountability, because especially in a learning group, but I think this is true of all good cooperative relationships, everyone in the cooperative relationship needs to get up and walk away stronger, strengthened.
Oh, I like that.
And there is no hitchhiking in a cooperative group. Hmm. Maybe in a poorly structured group there is, but not in a cooperative group. The cooperation comes when there is also individual accountability. Each of us need to know the material. It's not enough for one of us to know it. Each of us need to know it. Mm-hmm. And then there is a set of behaviors. Social psychologists would call these cooperative skills that need to be looked at. Small group leadership, communication, trust building, decision making, conflict resolution. Those are the kinds of things that need to be taught. And as the group gets more skillful, achievement goes up. So as a science educator, I remind my science teachers, the more skillful your lab groups are, the more they'll learn. So spend some time teaching skills. Mm-hmm. And then the other two, group processing, says that some time needs to be set aside for us to say, how well did we do on the task, but also how well did we do in our work with each other, and what could we do to be even better? Mm-hmm. And you process that, you talk about it. Every good cooperative group I know processes. And then the last one is, we describe as face-to-face interaction. And it's a promotive interaction, it's a presence. It says, as we work together, I get to know you better and better, and I get to read you better and better, and you get to read me. And it's an important component.
All of these things sound wonderful for any, I was just adjusting in my mind to what we're doing here.
This is a very good example.
Any kind of working together with people, those are wonderful. And I'm sure people
certainly
can go to your website, which we'll put on the air, and find more about this.
Sure.
Now, many people are going to ask me, and you don't have to give me, you know, a great detail, but one of the questions today is about best practices, what's mm-hmm. really working. So the question is there research to show that this is something very valuable, cooperative learning, that is?
Yeah, I think that's a good step, by the way. We're finally beginning to look at what we do in schools, and instead of passing things down from one generation of teachers to another without examining them very carefully, we're saying what kinds of practices have research support and research behind them. And this one certainly does. It's perhaps because it's an old idea, it has had an advantage. The research that we have gathered at the University of Minnesota in the Cooperative Learning Center goes back to the late 1800s. There's something like 800 plus studies that have looked and compared people learning cooperatively, competitively, individualistically. They're all age levels, all subject matters. And they've been done in times in history where we were emphasizing competition, and they've been done in times in history where we were emphasizing working individually. And they have a very, very consistent message. I guess it shouldn't surprise us, but the message that comes out of that is, if when you put people together to learn and get them really invested in each other's learning, a lot of good things happen. Achievement goes up. They develop more positive attitudes toward the subject matter, toward each other, even in very diverse settings. More acceptance of differences grows. Self-esteem increases. So on lots and lots of different measures, we are saying essentially in the classroom, when people are learning, that people are at their best when they're connected to each other. And maybe at their worst when they're isolated away from each other for long periods of time.
Hmm. You know, I can't help but say that I do agree with what you're saying, but there are the naysayers and the critics mm-hmm. who say, you know, we may be doing a disservice to these students because we live in a competitive world. Mm-hmm. You've probably heard this too.
Yeah.
And they say, you're not preparing these students by coddling them in these little groups to face the competitive world that we live in. How do you answer that?
Well, I think I have a younger brother who's a social psychologist, so that helps. So he and I, and it was one of the questions I asked early in our relationship, because I had been fed that material as well as a very young teacher. And he said, "If look around you, take another look carefully. Take a look at your life. What you're not seeing is that probably 90% of what you're involved in and what you do each day is part of an elaborate cooperative network. Hmm. And competition is a relatively small part. I mean, we don't grow our own food. We don't police our own cities. We have an elaborate division of labor as a society, cooperative division of labor, and everybody does their piece and their part, and it contributes to the greater good of everyone. And it's supposed to. It is a cooperative relationship.
And it's true that almost anything of any value, any major endeavor, doesn't work if it's just one person. I mean, if George Washington were all by himself and had no cooperation, where would we be?
British.
We would all be in Great Britain.
That's right.
Probably true. Well, I'm going to just take a break at this point, because when we come back, I've been hearing you speak about the group interdependence, and then several times you've talked about individual accountability. Mm-hmm. And lots of parents don't really want to hear about the group. They want to know, how do you evaluate my one student? Mm-hmm. And college students want to know, how am I doing?
Mm-hmm.
So when we come back, this is important to a lot of our viewers. We'll talk about that kind of dichotomy, or is it linked, as you say, the interdependence of a group and the individual's achievement. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Everyone has their own idea of a hero.
Magic Johnson, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Mr. Neal.
My hero, Gloria Stefan.
Martin Luther King, Mr. Hope.
These are teachers, but to the kids they've reached, they're heroes. They've given them hope. They've given them choices. They've changed their lives.
Well, the children are the heroes.
The most fulfilling thing is watching a child succeed.
I just like to help them make their dreams come true.
Teachers have the power to wake up young minds, to be heroes, to make a difference. Reach for that power. Teach. If you want to make an impact on our future, call 1-800-45-TEACH.
Mr. Wilkins.
Mrs. Eisenhardt.
Mr. Adler.
Be a teacher. Be a hero.
Come on, David. Come on, David.
Let's go, David. Come on.
Come on, David. You got the love.
Get as involved in your kids' education as in everything they do, and imagine the success they might find. Stay in touch with the teacher. Visit the school. For more tips, call 1-800-281-1313.
Dr. Johnson,
yeah.
As I said just before the break, so many parents really, they want to know, even all the way through high school and in college, the students want to know, how am I doing? So in your work, you talk about two parts, the interactive nature of the group and individual achievement.
Mm-hmm.
How are they linked? And then maybe we'll talk about how you evaluate an individual student.
Yeah, the two of them, the positive interdependence and individual accountability, are kind of two sides of the same coin. That's where a cooperative effort starts. The positive interdependence is the cooperative part, and the individual accountability is the, what do I walk away from this group with? What do I own having been here? And sometimes we describe it as group to individual transfer. You learn it in a group, and then you practice it alone. You learn it in a group, and you do it alone. And so that a very good way, a very appropriate way to test whether or not a group has been successful is to test each of the people individually.
Oh, and you know, I like the way you said that. You can learn it in the group and then you go away. I think everything happens like that. We all listen to something on the radio, but if we don't you know, own it and walk away and use it. It's mm-hmm. sort of lost. I like the way you said, and I like the way you said earlier something about we should all walk away stronger. Am I getting
you
that
bet.
Correctly?
Yes.
I like that because everyone then gets something from mm-hmm. this cooperative group. And now to that individual achievement, I think you have three ways, three areas that you talk about, assessment, evaluation, and reporting.
Mm-hmm.
And is that on an, how would you do that on an individual student?
Well, we think cooperative learning actually fits very nicely within kind of a wide range of assessment, evaluation, and reporting systems.
Now, excuse me, but are you saying that it fits into this high-stakes testing world?
Certainly.
Ah!
Certainly does.
Okay.
In a very nice way. Because what every teacher wants, what every educator wants, whatever every parent wants, is for more kids to achieve higher. And sometimes we get kind of myopically focused on our own child, but if we really want to look at the next generation and the generation our child is growing up in, we'd like to have lots of people who are who have achieved well, and
yeah.
lots of people who are well informed, and lots of people who vote on issues because they know the issue and they've thought about it, and that's the kind of America that they're looking for. And one of the things that cooperative learning does is it sort of, if you look at the research, there's a research promise there that says more students will learn more material if you put them together cooperatively for not the whole time, but for a substantial amount of the time. Because cooperative learning doesn't replace teaching. It usually follows good teaching.
Now, when you say teaching, you mean where the professor or
where
teacher
gives teaches,
information.
Yeah. It doesn't replace that. The teacher teaches, and then the group translates that and makes it real for each other and encourages each other to learn it. And sometimes when we're not feeling like learning on a given day, we need a little encouragement, and peer encouragement tends to be very powerful, much more so really than adult encouragement. And so if more students are achieving more material, what happens to test scores, especially high stakes test scores, where you're looking at a class mean or a school mean, is the mean goes up. People know more, they test better. And interestingly enough, although it's clear that bright students do very well in cooperative groups, partly because they get a chance often to explain the material, and in explaining it, learn it more deeply and remember it longer. The big jumps in achievement, the larger jumps, as are where you'd expect them to be, they're the under-motivated students, the struggling students, when they get peer help and support, up they go. So if I wanted to raise the mean score of a classroom in a hurry, I know exactly how to do it. Give the kids enough time working cooperatively so that they can help one another, and up goes the mean score.
I heard you just say, give them enough time.
Mm-hmm.
Is that part of the issue, where people are feeling, I've got to get all this material covered, so I better just tell it to the students?
Yes.
Is that part of the pressure that teachers might be feeling?
Especially teachers, I think. Teachers, and I don't know exactly where the messages come from, but I think all of us who are teachers think we need to cover the curriculum, we need to cover the material, and yet, it's interesting, all of the major curriculum areas in the United States that I know of, the National Science Teachers Association, the National Council of Teachers Mathematics, all of these curriculum areas are saying to teachers now, teach less, teach it better. Don't cover the material, go into more depth. And do a better job of teaching students in a way that they not only have learned it, but they remember it, and it's useful, and they can put it to good use.
It does almost sound contradictory to hear both of those messages, you know, that all this stuff is going to be on a test, but in fact, teachers know that what you've just said, to teach it for real learning, is far more important than flying over the material, hoping that they will show it on a test. Values right now, everything you're talking about speaks to me of having value for every child, and value for learning and so forth, and just value for democracy that you've kind of alluded to. And values, that word is on everybody's lips lately. And you compare three types of interaction. And I'm wondering if you could show us what are the different kind of values that come from them. I think you have, again, the cooperative, competitive, and individualistic. Mm-hmm. Could you talk about how what values flow from those three segments?
Sure. What we've looked at is what the interaction patterns do in terms of student behavior. So if you and I were in competition with each other, if we were trying to do better than one another, we would be not sharing information with each other. That would be silly. Why would I share good information with you when I'm trying to outdo you or do better? Competition, when it's low-key and fun and constructive, can be very powerful. And we are not against competition in the classroom. We are very much for appropriate competition, mm-hmm. where it is low-key and fun. When it gets serious, though, it gets strange. For example,
strange, yes.
Well, the pre-med students at the University of Minnesota, where I come from, there was a little expose a few years ago that said one of the things that they would do in order to enhance their chances for making medical school is they would razor blade the key pages out of the books on reserve in the library for the class so that they had them and nobody else did.
Oh.
And that's not only an odd behavior, that's a strange set of values. On the other hand, when we look at the cooperative work that kids do in the classroom, we find that kids, and we test the kids often to see kind of what are they saying about working cooperatively. Well, some of the things they say is, I like working with people who think differently than I do.
Ah.
Because it makes me think too. Or I like working with people who have different points of view because I enjoy arguing intellectually.
mm-hmm.
And still being able to go to the lunchroom arm in arm because we're arguing about ideas here and not people. And there's a whole set of cooperative values that come out of working together cooperatively that are very important to a democracy, very important to people who are growing up in a society that has on the one hand a set of shared group goals and on the other hand different perspectives and different points of view that need to be examined and looked at.
So all of those things have their place is what I'm hearing.
That's correct.
The individual.
That's correct.
The competitive,
in
the right perspective,
mm-hmm.
and of course, constantly the cooperation between groups and learning. Earlier, when I introduced the subject, I mentioned how industry and business mm-hmm. is asking for more skilled workers, but they're not just worried about can you read, write, computer, or run a computer, but they want people who can work in groups. Now, you speak in some of your workshops, I quoted this from one of your flyers, that your workshop speaks about constructive interaction and group processing. You've referred to some of these things along the way. And development of small interpersonal skills.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do those things translate into the workplace? I mean, they're calling for people, you have to have high skills, but we want you to know how to work on a team. And you're talking about what you're saying about learning about group interaction and small group interpersonal skills. Can you put that into a work context for me?
Sure. We've had an opportunity actually to work with the business sector some and to work with people who do a lot of training and work in the business sector. David did a couple of sessions with W.W. Deming, one of the people that we sent to Japan to try to reorganize Japanese industry at the end of World War II, and did such obviously a wonderful job. And one of the things that comes out is how similar the kinds of things we're doing in a third grade math class are to exactly what's being done with a group of engineers or other people in a business and industry setting, teaching them how to work as a team, teaching them the same skills, communication skills, conflict resolution skills, trust building skills, small group leadership skills, decision making skills. And we think it's very important that these people are working in the business sector and doing that, but we think executive training ought to start at about age 5, not wait until age 45.
Right. And not wait until some competitive nation is using it to show us mm-hmm. that we ought to be using more of this in American education.
Correct.
And in American industry.
Correct.
just before we close in a few minutes, I wonder if you'd be willing to share a major frustration or disappointment. Nothing's perfect.
No.
So I wonder if what is it that troubles you about getting the word out and getting to see people implement it correctly?
Well, I think when we first started, the struggle was because we were looking at how do students meet and interact with each other, relationships of students with one another. We had a hard time getting anybody to listen because students weren't supposed to interact with each other in class. They were supposed to work on their own by themselves and not copy and not look on each other's paper. And that was frustrating. And that's passed. Cooperative learning, I think, is now accepted by all major education places. I think what's frustrating is that so many people stop with just putting the people in groups and telling them to go to work, and they don't take the trouble to structure the cooperation and to teach the skills and to encourage the groups to become better and better.
You know, we'll put your email or your site at the end of the show, because people, you've written books and articles and you have so much on your site, and we're coming to the end of our show, so we'll put that there so they can find out more about what Dr. Johnson is referring to here, about going beyond putting people together. Can you in 30 seconds tell me what's the greatest accomplishment?
Actually, I used to say this when I was younger because I was always the shortest kid in the room. Really, really great things come in small packages. So, and some of our greatest successes come in small packages. One shy kid who speaks, one struggling kid who has an insight and learns something, one very bright child who shares their information with other people in a way that they understand it and they walk away happy.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to have you back again. Bridgewater State College must invite you back again. Thank you so much. Appreciated this, Dr. Johnson. In closing, considering the growing diversity in our country and the unique vision of education that we have in America, it seems to me that cooperative learning, which celebrates each and every child, should be front and center in our education dialogue, which you know I call school talk.